Hello and welcome everyone to the virtual conference on how online gaming has benefited from the lockdown by Entrepreneur India. I am Preetima Bhardwaj, Project Head Webinars at Entrepreneur. Today's discussion will revolve around, at a time when people are stuck at home with so much time, online gaming has seen an unprecedented surge in interest. Still in nascent stages in India, the pandemic has put the focus firmly on the innumerable opportunities that lie within the industry. Let me start by laying out the ground rules for our attendees. This discussion will go on for 1 hour 15 minutes. This will be followed by a question and answer session for next 15 to 20 minutes. If you have any questions during the course of the discussion, you can post them through the Q&A option at the bottom of your screen. Mention in your question if it is directed at any specific panelist. We will take up questions post the panel discussion. Please participate in poll during the webinar. We would also like to request the attendees to keep the questions within the scope of the discussion here today and not pitch their businesses. Let me now introduce Mr. Thumaria, the Editor-in-Chief of Entrepreneur India and Asia Pacific, who would give the welcome note. Over to you, Ritu.
Thank you, Pratima, and a very good afternoon to everyone from the gaming fraternity. We've been doing a lot of webinars and we've been talking to lots of industries, but I can tell you this, that this is perhaps the only industry where our data has shown some great spurt. And we're talking about, this industry as if there was no lockdown and there was nothing wrong in the world. And it's good to see an industry in the boom time. The only industry where I saw this kind of spike was probably in EdTech. And of course, EdTech and gaming is probably somehow going to merge in the coming times, with gamification and education becoming all the more important. But having said that, I was just seeing some data around how gaming has changed, and I came across some extremely interesting facts. One, of course, is that online, it is almost as popular as music is. So people listen to the same amount of music as they play games, and its usage is only second to social media, which is really, really a lot. Today it accounts, particularly since the lockdown, it has accounted for pretty much 35% for all app downloads that have been happening. 74% of the consumer spend that is happening online today is probably happening in gaming, and 10% of all time spent in apps, which was never the case earlier. The industry is so gung-ho about the growth that it is expected that if it continues to grow in this space, even if it falls down a little bit after the lockdown, that by 2021, there would be at least a spend on, people will spend about $180 billion on mobile games, which is like a lot. It's like the industry to invest in. In fact, I think these figures are probably also prompting both new age investors as well as traditional investors like your Blackstones and Goldman Sachs to invest in more hyper-casual gaming market, which continues to dominate the market. Of course, just prior to the close lockdown, we had also seen sports gaming becoming very, very big. But of course, with gaming events now postponed indefinitely, we don't know how that spike will happen. But again, if I were to look at the larger pie, then certainly it's looking very positive and very, very large. Also, at the same time, what is interesting to see is that the average age of a mobile gamer is probably about 36 years today. This used to be about 27 years earlier, back in 2015 or something. And today, about 51% female, imagine, more are playing, and 49% of males are actually playing online games. So good to see, the female force is busy playing games there, not just cooking at home. And also, the 1/3 of all the gamers are aged between 36 to 50 years within it. And I think what really makes this industry really, really very exciting from a investment perspective, from a business perspective, is that it is easy to establish. It's easy to establish a gaming studio. Of course, ideas have to be very novice. Ideas have to be very, very exciting for a gaming business or a gaming startup to do well. But on the other side, on an investment side, there are less investment involved. A gaming studio is relatively cheaper to put up than an e-commerce setup. And probably also that, it's a very data-led model. So, you can actually quantify what kind of business and what volumes of interest generation and therefore revenues are happening in the business. Therefore, it's very easy. And see, as I said, both traditional as well as new set of investors are interested in it. In fact, we're just going to have Kalari speak and tell us about why they feel gaming is a great sector from a trend perspective. You know, we have a stellar lineup of speakers here today who are represent the various shades of the gaming world, and they're going to give you some great insights today. So welcome once again to the e-gaming webinar here that we've organized for you, and we look forward to some great time, great questions, great interaction happening, and great insights by our speakers. Welcome once again. Over to you, Pratima.
Thank you, Ritu. So we start with the first keynote session. Our speaker for this session is Mr. Manish Agarwal, CEO, Nazara Technologies. Mr. Agarwal will be speaking on the evolution of online gaming. This session is for about 20 minutes, followed by a Q&A session. Please post your questions in the Q&A button mentioned at the bottom of your screen. Over to you, Mr. Agarwal.
Thanks, Pratima. Thanks, Ritu. Can you guys hear me all?
Yes, crystal.
All right. So Pratima, you said something which was very interesting. You said gaming is still very nascent. One of the reason I thought, let me use this COVID lockdown to show some grays on my beard and some grays on my locks. I've been talking about gaming is going to take off since last decade, I think 2011. And it has been this whole thing of that India is a sleeping tiger and it's going to really be awakened very soon. And I remember talking in multiple conferences, which I've stopped doing because I got tired of saying that India is going to happen, India is going to happen, China has happened. So it is heartening to see that you're still saying it's nascent. Yeah, so there's a lot of more effort to do. And I think a lot of other panelists who are a decade younger to me, they don't see the same state as what I've seen in last decade. So yeah, gaming, I think, is happening. Gaming is happening, and I don't think there is any doubt in anybody's mind in the gaming industry, even before COVID, that gaming was happening. I am glad that this unfortunate event, which we are all kind of locked now, has brought gaming to mainstream and into the mainstream thinking of a lot of people because of absence of live sports happening and other industries really kind of relatively showing some kind of despair, and people finding that little ray of hope amongst all the gloom and doom stories which people keep hearing. And I think gaming is one of those industries besides education tech, which really people see a hope to cling on. And that's why we are all suddenly in demand. So for us, it is nice to see. It is nice to see vindication of a long decade personally for me, where I believe that gaming in India would be far bigger as an entertainment option than anything else. So I think it's a good moment for all of us to really kind of get into it and then really look at what is the model. I think Ritu mentioned something very interesting. She mentioned about the age of people who are playing games. And I've been really, you know, tired talking to answering a lot of brand managers, answering a lot of agencies that gaming is equal to kids. So we will not really be participating in advertising in gaming. Ritu, if you are okay, I would like to have you as chief evangelist of gaming, because all the data points you said are so apt and so nicely put across that you should really have a forum where you get all the brand marketeers from all the reputable MNCs, my erstwhile MNC, where I used to work.
For sure.
Yeah. And please evangelize gaming, because gaming is not equal to kids. I have explained it to multiple people. You said average age is 27, pre-COVID, now it is 36. To me, the reason I went to gaming, honestly, in 2011-12 in 2014 is when I saw India will happen on gaming, was when I went to Lucknow, which is my hometown, and I saw my mom playing Candy Crush. So 2014 was a moment for me. I said, holy shit, what is she playing? And then I said, hello, what is this? She said, no, I have a score to do. And I had never seen my mom talking about a mobile game so passionately. And I said, why are you so enchanted? She said, no, there's a kitty. In my kitty, some people are playing, and hence I really kind of got into it. And to me, that was kind of fascination that my mom, who was not using WhatsApp at that point of time, had latched on to Candy Crush because of word of mouth and playing on her mobile phone, which was very, I think, early standards smartphone. And I said, this is where the gaming has to happen. And this is when, in my previous avatar, I was focused on US and European markets on gaming. And then I said, this is the time in 2014-15 when one should start focusing on India market. The gaming is about to happen. So I think the gaming was always being done all across age groups. And today it's even more pronounced. Whether you're looking at people playing virtual cricket, they're missing their own cricket outside, or they want to relive their childhood through carom, or they are really kind of playing something else. From that perspective, I think today the age group is cutting across. I would broadly tell you what has been the opportunity and challenges of COVID. Life is always, you know, a mixed bag. It is never that you will always be on one particular axis and you're moving forward. The flavor of the, as again, Ritu, you mentioned, was sports fantasy, which was really kind of darling of the market last 18 months, 24 months. And suddenly everybody was kind of talking about sports fantasy. I think the live sports or dependency has been there. And if you were kind of really are totally 100% dependent, your revenues are dependent on one live sports. It was unthinkable. It was a scenario when somebody does MBA like me, does a risk modeling and says that, okay, what's the probability of this happening? A 1% probability that entire world will have no live sports. You will say, nah, not 1%. It may be 0.1%. And then you will do a 2 hours intellectual discussion on that particular aspect, right? But that is reality now. It has happened, and then all those scenarios are being discussed. So what has happened is that new business models have now really come into the fore. I think the whole aspects of esports, which has really kind of become very sexy to say. Now everybody is kind of talking about esports, from all the brands which really didn't understand, to all the people, investors who are looking at esports, to various definitions of esports, which has interestingly emerged. People doing tournaments around games, calling them esports, or people doing just a multiplayer game, calling them esports, or a virtual cricket game being called as esports. So you have a variety of definition of esports, right? But that's really good thing, because when more people talk about a terminology, as we used to say when I was in FMCG, the true test of your brand being really popular is that then you have fakes happening in the market, right? So today, if a lot of people are talking about esports and a lot of journalists are writing about esports, mainstream journalists, so you know that there is something which is really building up. So I think that's one particular thing that the share of mind of esports has really kind of taken off. And I believe that's not really a fad. It is going to stay here, because there are brands, there are OTT platforms, there are linear TV platforms, which have now understood that they need a certain amount of their share of dollars to be spread beyond cricket, carom, cricket, football, basketball, all that stuff. And there is a very sizable audience, eyeballs, professional players, amateur players, the whole ecosystem, which is available for you to really look at and play and watch and compete, the whole proposition, which is important. To me, esports in a very purest form is very simple. People watching people playing video games, that's esports. Any other formation of that is really a convenience definition which has been created to attract dollars. And now, if you were to kind of look at that, today you may have 100, 120 million PUBG users, give or take a few million here and there. Then you have Free Fire, and then you have all other games. So you have a sizable number of people who are playing games. And then there are at the top will be a 50,000, 100,000 professional players whose skill sets are really good and who will build their fan following like any other sports. And I think that's the whole pyramid from zero to hero is really going to emerge in this country very soon. And which is directly proportional to more dollars being spent on building ecosystem, on building prize pool, on building competition teams, all that stuff. So I think that's one big thing which is really going to happen. And as I said, it's not going to go away. This is a serious contender for a share of pie of sports business. Maybe 5, 7, 8 years back when kabaddi happened and soccer happened, you would see that from the urban, even not even just urban, the beauty of the PUBGs of the world is that it is spread across pop strata. It is not stuck to South Bombay, somebody playing on a 2.5 lakh gaming gear. A 5,000, 8,000 rupees Android phone is good enough for me to become a PUBG player. So I think the reach which mobile-based esports will give will be tremendous. And I think this will disrupt the whole pie chart of the revenue of sports in next 3 to 5 years. And the habit formation is being accelerated now. You would see a lot of esports guys who have already built fan following. They're clocking 30, 40 million views in last 10 days, 15 days. And people are just consuming more and more of them. So I think that's one thing which is really going to here to stick here and not going anywhere else, right? Second thing, I believe the whole education and edutainment and gamification. If you were to create a trisection of these three things and then create that as a pillar of offering for the consumers, which could be your 2 to 7 year olds or 7 to 12 year olds and then 12 to 18 kind of stuff. But this intersection of entertainment, gaming and education is here to stay. And that is really going to create a lot of opportunities, whether Byju's will appear from content to gamification or Nazara will take it from gaming to education. But that intersection is really going to come and stay here, and that's not going to be changing at all. We are seeing ourselves a great kind of in our kids subscription app, which is aimed for 2 to 6 year olds. We are seeing great traction of that really happening as we speak. Again, I believe that habit is going to be long lasting. You may settle at a higher, you may not settle at the current peak, but the new normal will be much higher than the pre-COVID. And the adoption and the propensity to pay, which is an important element in gaming, because we keep talking about users and dollars, the lag between the two. Here, in terms of subscription, you would see that really closing in very fast, because a good familiarity, when you, especially in the younger kids, we have seen being a parent of two, that the familiar content breeds more and more content consumption, more renewals. Because unlike adults, kids love watching something which they are familiar with and they have been used to watching. So I think that's the second thing which really is going to be staying here and doing well. Third piece, I believe that if you were to look at social multiplayer, given that we are socially alive as human beings, given that we are a young population, we love and we are very competitive, social multiplayer games would be a new thing which will continue to happen. Now, there could be formats. The formats could be, I'm playing team versus team, I'm playing one versus one. But ultimately what it is new addas. I believe the gaming games are the new communities. That is what is really going to be the defining moment for people, because a game just offers a great context and great experience, great new experience all the time, fresh experience all the time when you come and play. And that's why the games are going to become new community, because you're not just consuming, you are interacting. And it's like sports. You are having a new experience, unpredictability all the time, which leads to conversations. And that's what I believe. Fortnite today would be the biggest game, like Second Life. They are already moving towards that direction. We believe closer to home, you're playing cricket, like our WCC game, which has 3-4 million people playing every day for almost 52 minutes. And that's, Ritu, the data which you said after social media. So we are seeing in cricket game, people spend average 52 minutes per day. And it's we are not talking about some 300 people. We are talking about 3.5 million people every day. And that's the kind of time spent which we are seeing in the game. And what we are seeing is content to connection will happen in games very quickly, because the context is of multiplayers. The context is to make friends, acquaintances and friends, which will happen much faster. And I think that whole behavior is being accelerated under COVID because of the social distancing, your lockdown at your home. You may have your initial concentric circle of your own physical friends who were you used to hang out, then your other acquaintances. But very soon, you kind of start getting habit of playing the game more and more and making more unknown people, meeting unknown people through a game and then getting to acquaintance and friendship. I think that's the third thing which is really going to be a long-lasting impact. And games being the new communities is going to be reality, which is really going to happen. I think the fourth thing which I personally, it's not so much of a consumer habit, but I believe all of us in gaming are very, very, should be very sensitive about it and very cognizant about it, is responsible gaming. We are not a gaming nation. We always have, as our parents have, we as parents have an issue with any kid spending more time on gaming and not studying. It is always that stigma, it is always that myth that, hey, listen, you're wasting your time. When we used to be kids, playing cricket wasn't a stigma. Today, playing virtual mobile games will be a stigma. As parents see a secure, safe future for their kids, they become more comfortable in letting their kids do it. But till that time, that apprehension stays, they will not allow to do it. That is one part, given that cultural sensitivity is very high. We should be very, very careful about responsible gaming. Second, the whole piece about skill-based gaming where I can make real money by cash in, cash out. I think that's another one, which is very interesting concept in India, which is very unique to us, which has really become big. It is really growing very fast. But again, what kind of incentivizing, what kind of enticing, what kind of Lakshman Rekha do we kind of draw? It is very important for the industry and for people like us who are running it to be very cognizant of it. Because given the underlying cultural sensitivity, it is very easy for knee-jerk reactions and policies to emerge, which could really throw baby out of bathtub. And that's why it is very important that a self-regulatory framework, a responsible gaming thought process mindset is very important and not get carried away with the whole euphoria that this is the gold rush and let's all kind of get into and do that. Last thing which I would like to conclude is, while gaming is exciting, gaming is good, my advice to a lot of youngsters is that this is like gold rush. There'll be few peoples who will be able to strike gold, but there'll be many other guys who will fall by the wayside. Be careful about it. Think properly, be agile. Don't get carried away by your own romantic ideas. And just look at what is consumer telling you about your game, about your offering. Quickly find the product market fit without you really burning your hands too much into about your own thesis. And it is very easy to get caught in your thesis in industries like gaming because there is no precedence. And you can always say, hey, listen, I'm going to make the precedence because I'm so smart and I'm so stuck. That's fine. But please validate it with the consumers quickly and take that with lots of reality and don't wish it away that my consumers don't know and don't smoke what you're cooking at. So I think that's where I would really kind of end. Ritu, I can't hear you.
Yeah, that sure made a lot of sense, Manish. So we've got some questions coming as you were talking. So I'm going to probably ask a few people to actually ask you these questions. Can we give the audio to Manish Jain? He has got quite a few questions to ask you.
I think you should limit to one or two.
that's what we'll do.
and let others get full chance. And if somebody is still not wanting to have question, you can give my ID. Happy to interact later.
Sure. Chirag, can we give the audio to Manish?
Okay, I have the audio. Can you hear me?
Yeah, but Manish, please restrict to one or two very important questions. We don't have time for all seven.
All right, maybe then rest of the questions I can, as he has
mentioned. Yes, you can. Yeah, he can. Yeah, all right. Please go ahead. Ask
Hi, Manish. This is Manish Jain. I'm from Delhi. So, it's lovely. I came to know whatever you have discussed over here. Now, what kind of online gamings are legally allowed to be played in India just for the objective of winning money? Like these days, I'm seeing so many ads coming up for MPL and people like on TV, they are saying they've won 50,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees. Is that legally allowed over here?
I think that question, I leave it to Pawan, who will be a part of panelist, and you ask him. He is a thesis in that.
Oh, okay. And again, like my next question is related to that only, then maybe I can just talk to him. Or can we like tie up with your company and we can just be a part of that for making it a like a game, playing games or for from business point of view?
Yeah, so Manish, I would need to defer it to subsequent. Let's do a business development discussion off the call.
Sure. Let's thank you, Manish Chen. We're now giving the audio to Nilay Joshi. Is
Hello.
Nilay?
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you, Nilay. Go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, Manish.
So
just one question, right? I mean, because we have seen the rise of games like Fortnite or PUBG, right? And like you correctly mentioned that during this lockdown period, this because of social distancing, multiplayer games has increased a lot, right? But do you see maybe even like in after 4 or 5 months, if you know like lockdown gets more easy and the people would start working? So, I mean, will we see rise of maybe people focusing more on single player games or still, I mean, there will be a huge increase in multiplayer games?
See, Nile, if you look at the gaming, just a natural thing. What do you enjoy more? Do you really enjoy more playing with your friends or do you enjoy playing alone? So when you play any of the physical game, you play soccer or you play carom within premise or you play cricket or you play badminton, you really enjoy playing with your friends. I think that's a very natural thing to do. And if you look at the history of mobile gaming or any kind of video gaming, it has moved from a single player to multiplayer gaming with as the infrastructure has evolved. Because that's a natural evolution of how human mind really enjoys and gets more dopamine. So I don't think that is really the COVID is any reason. COVID has just accelerated it because you are sitting at home and you are playing that. In office, you may not be able to consume. But here, three things are coming to your thing. One, a lot of your friends or a lot of people are online and hence concurrency of users is not an issue. That is basic given for a multiplayer game. Second thing is you really are kind of feeling lonely and missing your friends and you are kind of doing that, right? Third is that our internet infrastructure has really improved over the last 3 years, and which is why you see a lot of single player happening earlier. But as the infrastructure keeps improving, you would see more and more multiplayer game adoption happening. And monetization in free-to-play mobile games, what we call freemium, is directly proportional to multiplayer games where people are playing 1v1 or 3v3 or 5v5. Or even the contesting which is happening in the real money skill games is directly proportional to concurrency and internet infrastructure. So I think this is not something, as I said, it's a habit which will be formed and it has been accelerated by this behavior and that adoption is great. Somebody was telling me that Ludo has 90 million monthly active users, Ludo King. Now, can you imagine at one point of time, a few weeks back, it was number one app, not number one gaming app. Before Zoom took it over. Now, 90 million people playing Ludo. Why would they be playing Ludo when they have a physical Ludo in their house and they can play? The very simple thing is that I want to play with more and more people and I want to build my more concentric circles of friends with different kind of variety. There could be some friend group, there could be family group, there could be some unknown group, there could be city groups. So I think that's where it is really happening. Obviously, will Ludo remain at 90 million monthly active users? Absolutely not. But will it come down to a 30-40? The earlier thing, it may settle at 50-60. Because now people will find that habit. The frequency may not be 4 times a week or 5 times a week. It may be twice a week. But that all is going to continue. I think this is a steroid for a multiplayer.
Sure. We'll give the next question to Darshit Shah, but while he's Darshit is coming online, I have a question for you, Manish. I also came across this data that there has been an average spend of about $65 on bots, mostly by Generation Z. Do you see this becoming a practice, and do you see this becoming a great revenue tool for gaming companies?
I don't think, I didn't understand fully, but if I were to kind of interpret it, using people playing as bots?
No, not people playing. People using bots to, let's say, win the game or, using maybe those.
So there'll be always hackers, Ritu. And there are always very smart people, right? And that's where the job of any, especially, and these bots will come into more and more picture on, especially when you're looking at skill games for real money. Right? Because a self-learning bot, which could really improvise, let's say, a game of quiz or a game of, let's say, archery or a game of, let's say, a knife or anything which is requires a deterministic skills with, when I attain, I can really win over others, right? Now, if you can really kind of create that kind of a program, an AI, which is really able to be doing better than others, you will do that. But I'm saying as a game offerings, I really know that how do I control them? How do I preempt them? And they are not good for the overall ecosystem because that really leads to this resentment among other users. But it's a cat and mouse game, and I think it will continue forever.
Sure. But does a gaming company lose money because of it?
Gaming company loses money definitely at multiple levels because let's say if I'm a very good bot and you are a newbie, I can clean you up and you will never come back.
Does it make sense to have in-house bots too?
No, absolutely no. And it is, I think it is illegal and unethical.
Sure. So I think Darshit Shah is there already.
Yes. Am I audible?
Yes,
Darshit. Hi.
Yeah. Hi, Manish. This is Darshit from Dhyan Industries. We have met some time back with Raj Kundra. So just one question which I have, I need to understand your perspective, that which form of gaming do you see will gain the maximum attraction? Will it be real money gaming or casual gaming or in esports? Maybe.
See, the beauty of India, is,
yeah, go ahead.
We have 500 million smartphone people. And a lot of people have made a mistake of looking India as one homogeneous market. India is not a homogeneous market, will never be a homogeneous market. It will always be heterogeneous sets of homogeneous offerings. So you will have a very strong market, which will be doing multiplayer games on freemium. It will have a very strong market for casual games. It will have very strong market for skill-based real games. And it will have a very strong market for esports. Think of ourselves like this. Even 100 million people playing mid-core games or hardcore games is bigger than combination of many European countries, and that's the size of this market, right? So it is never going to be that one form of gaming is going to really dominate in this country, but there are segment size itself are so big that you could really create scalable large businesses in India from those segments, which is why, for example, at Nazara, we have diversified offerings because that's my or learning from my Unilever days that there will be a wheel and there would be a rim and there would be a surf and there would be a surf Excel and Excelmatic.
Sure. We'll take one final question from Sarthak Doshi in interest of time. If we could give him the audio, please.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes.
Hi, Sarthak.
Hi. My single question is on your when you described about esports as everyone using the same term to market their games. I would just like your thoughts on how would you define esports and if there is a categorization that you can think of in the gaming industry, what would those gaming categories be? In like looking at different business models, what would be the categories you would see in the gaming industry?
Yaar, tumne teen question puche hai question mein.
So, okay, I'll limit it to one direct question. What would you say when you say esports and is there any category that you see in the gaming industry?
It's very simple, yeah. For me, esports is a media business. It is like your any other sports. It is defined by people watching players playing. As simple as that. And if you really understand the value chain, it will be the platforms where the people are coming to watch. It'll be streamer, it's live streaming and content creators, which will be working with the game publishers to ensure that that content reaches to those platforms. That's a simple value chain. Now, in that value chain, you will have to figure out where you are playing if your answer is on category. For example, we have taken a conscious call that we are not a TV channel. We are not going to be a Twitch. We are not a Prime. We are not Hotstar. We are very, very content to really be the largest, most dominant content company for esports in this country. We will dominate and we'll protect that with our life. We'll ensure that the quality of that content is global, and we would lead our thinking on mobile-based esports, the best thinking globally. Because we are sitting in India, which leads mobile sports, unlike US or Europe, which thinks PC-based esports. Right. So to me, that's where the esports is. Now, whether you are playing PUBG, or you are playing Fortnite, or you're playing Free Fire, or you're playing cricket. I'm in a conference call. Move. Sorry, guys. So that really doesn't matter. And for those are the games, and we will work with all game publishers to ensure that we are able to give great viewing experience to people on variety of platforms.
Sure. Well, we'll have to end with that. So, Manish, any parting thoughts from you for somebody who is a new enthusiast and wants to do a gaming startup?
As I said, look outside in rather than inside out.
Oh, that's a good one. Thank you very much, Manish. This was very insightful indeed. And hopefully next time we'll meet you actually in a physical place and we could have some animation there as we go.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thanks. Bye-bye. Thanks.
What's Q&A?
Over to you, Pritima.
Thank you, Manish. Thank you, Ritu. Moving on to our first panel of the day. This panel will be for about 60 minutes. Mm-hmm. Our panelists are Parth Chadha, founder Evor; Varun Mahana, founder and CEO Poker Dangal; Pavan Nanda, co-founder Winzo Games; Roland Rander, CEO All India Gaming Federation. And our moderator for this session is Mr. Rajesh Raju, Managing Director, Kalari Capital. I would now request Mr. Rajesh to start this session. Over to you, sir.
Hello, can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Then let me expand on this. Welcome, everyone. That was quite an interesting keynote from Manish. Of course, he's a veteran of the industry. And also good to hear some industry stats from Ritu as well before that. So thank you for that. I'm not going to go into the industry and the metrics and the numbers. I'll try and limit it to some of the questions that I have for the panelists here today. We have a very interesting panel, and some are veterans like Manish, and others are maybe new to this business, but I'm sure in a short period of time, entrepreneurship makes you, I guess, equally experienced. And we also have Roland, who can give us a flavor of the industry and where the industry has been and where it's headed in the future. So we have a very interesting panel. And I just setting the context here, we as investors, of course, we have tracked and have tracked gaming for a long time. And along with online education, by the way, for the last 10 years, I should say at least, that I can remember. And both those sectors, one, online education, we took early bets, at least for the last 8-9 years. And gaming, we were a little late. And both those sectors actually, like I think Manish and Ritu also might have mentioned, were sleepy sectors. They did not live up to the expectation, at least to our expectations in terms of growth and monetization for a long time. We struggled with education for a long time, although we have done fairly well. But it's never too late. We were fortunate over the last 3-4 years, we've been investors into the gaming industry. And fortunately, we made the right bets, and they've done very well for us. But still, the early years when we invested were tough. And the last 2 years, we have seen significant acceleration in the market, the monetization, the number of players. I hear the numbers are close to 300 million gamers now in India, expected to go to 500 million soon. The industry size is fast approaching $1 billion, and it'll be a couple of billion dollars in over the next 2 to 3 years. So high expectations for the industry. And there are some real solid companies that are built like Nazara. And we will see, at least our expectation is that we will see many, many multi-billion dollar companies in the gaming industry. It's been slow for that uptake the past 10 years, but the last 2 years have shown us great signs. And of course, this COVID could become an inflection point. That's why we are here today look into what are some of the behavioral changes, what are some of the permanent acceleration changes that are happening in the industry. And we'll learn from the great panel that we have today. So without further ado, I will jump right into Q&A with our panel. What I'll do is I'll ask my first question. I want everyone, including Manish, I think he's still around, I hope, all of you to take a minute and give the audience a flavor of what the industry was pre-COVID, because everyone is looking at the industry today with a fresh set of eyes, and they don't know all the turmoil that you went through, and what are some of the challenges that you faced educating the masses and bringing the masses onto the platform, which were very, very difficult. So I want you to paint a picture for me and for the audience here on the pre-COVID scenario for the gaming industry. Some of the trends, some of your business challenges, some of the legal regulatory challenges that you faced. So we'll start with Roland. I think he can give us a industry-wide glimpse into what it was pre-COVID. Roland, could you start with that? Then we'll move to the others. Roland, can you hear me?
Yeah, thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, you are. Please go ahead.
Yeah, okay, thanks. So, yeah, I think Manish already covered some of the numbers, right? Industry numbers. So, but yeah, you rightly summed it up actually, because in the last, although the industry is around for about a decade, it's only in the last two and a half years that there's been, traction that we've been seeing. At the AIGF, what we've done is broadly, we've categorized this into four buckets. So we have the card games, Rummy and Poker, and these are individual business segments in themselves. We also have the Daily Fantasy and now the digital sports gaming or digital esports. So these really make up the online real money skill gaming space that we are centered around. Of course, the online gaming industry itself is much bigger because, you know, there are companies that look at advertising as revenue streams and others, you know, through in-app purchases, etc. But we are really concentrated around the real money skill gaming side of the business. So pre-COVID, as you rightly said, you know, over the last 2 years, there's been a major traction that we've been seeing. And just before that also, you know, this part of the business clearly is in the area of about close to, you know, 4,500 crore right now. And there are some figures that, you know, EY just put together for the FICCI Frames report, which was released in March. And a lot of those data points went from our side at the AIGF. So in terms of number of gamers, you are right, in the excess of 300 million right now. But really, this is the entire gamut of online gaming. But suffice to say that, you know, in the pre-COVID era, there was enough and more traction. The number of, startups coming into the gaming landscape was growing. Number of gamers were growing. You know, the investor community also looking at it very positively. And this segment that I just spoke about was you know, quite robust to begin with, and a lot of attention that it was already drawing from all these stakeholder groups. From the one of the reasons for the increase obviously was the clarity in, you know, regulation around some of the games, although it continues to be a state subject, but that was one of the reasons. The other reason obviously being the India becoming digitally rich, whether it is in terms of payments or, you know, online transactions, and obviously the smartphone penetrations reaching 500 million, and all of that put together really in the pre-COVID era made it very, very a viable business proposition for all the stakeholders.
Great. Let's move on the same question to let's go to Parth of EWAR.
Yeah, thanks, Rajesh. So I think we were already there in terms of users had already got acquainted with online gaming. So transitioning from feature phones to smartphones and data getting cheaper. But since the beginning, like starting from Snakes, then Candy Crush, Farmville, and now PUBG. So people were already acquainted, but lockdown has definitely accelerated the entire user base and like attraction going more into gaming, more online traffic and people, the screen time increasing. But definitely Manish mentioned right that esports as a industry is growing. It would actually mirror what e-commerce was in the last 5 years. So we were already there, but lockdown has helped us a lot. And it's actually sensing that people never demanded us, but now the demand has increased because people sitting at home and getting access to more mobile smartphones, they're playing more and more games.
Great, Parth. Pawan, would you like to share some of your pre-COVID experiences in the industry?
Sure. So I think I would sort of sink in with the thoughts that others have shared. We were definitely, you know, growing very fast. To be very honest, we started off this business 2 years back, right? For the first 1 year or so, we were spending some time cracking the code, because we are a very, very vernacular rich platform. So cracking the code of tier 2, tier 5 audience, especially since we are real money. So we need to also make sure that people are comfortable doing microtransactions, right, on our platform. But last 12 months have been terrific for us. We've been growing 15 to 20% month on month. And of course, I mean, I would say for the first time in my life, you know, during this COVID fiasco, I've been on the right side of luck. The business is doing, it's booming now. I mean, you know, at some point we had to reach out to Amazon to scale our servers. That's the scenario. I would say, I think what's, you know, probably we are having these webinars now around gaming, and, you know, everybody is discussing gaming a lot more during Corona, because a tier one audience, or probably, you know, even white collar people, even, you know, corporate honchos, so to say, are these days, you know, spending time or catching up, playing PUBGs and Ludos and all kinds of games. But if you see a tier two, tier five, there the consumptions have always been very huge, because there, as you know, right, bits are more expensive than bytes. There they don't have shopping malls and movie halls where they catch up or they go out on weekends. There they anyway spend a lot of time on mobile devices. So they've always been doing that. It's only the lockdowns have happened, and you know, people are not being able to visit more, you know, moves and so what, and not is they're spending playing games in tier one a lot more, and that's why this topic is even being discussed now. But I think from numbers point of view, from the trends point of view, I think the wave has already initiated a couple of years back, I would say, once Jio and smartphones have been sort of, you know, into the picture, and it has a very positive I would say prospect going forward, and some of these things will be very, very irreversible. So might I think I, you know, some, there are a lot of people who feel that you know, it's a very, very momentous tailwind. Things will die down very soon. But what I feel is there will definitely be, you know, things will die down very soon. But fundamentally, a lot will change, because a lot of people have been exposed to this kind of entertainment, right? With respect to gaming, a lot of people were fed up of, you know, just watching videos and spending time on social media. They got imbibed by gaming, and now it's going to be, you know, a life-changing experience for them.
Great. Pawan, thank you. I will ask Varun to paint a picture for us. He is part of that age-old, I guess, real money gaming industry, which has been around for a long time. Rummy and poker were traditionally the original games. Warren, could you tell us pre-COVID what your experiences were, what your challenges were?
Thanks, Rajesh. I mean, so we are a 2.5-year-old startup, and poker in India is very niche compared to Rummy, which is an age-old game. Poker is something which got introduced to India in the last decade or so. It's a very nascent industry. So the challenge is a little different for poker when it comes to talking about how do you educate the users? How do you tell them what poker is? Because compared to Rummy or compared to the other games which are being mentioned, poker requires a certain amount of homework, certain rules which have to be followed while playing the game. So it is not that everyone can just come up, pick up the sport and start playing. It requires a lot of practice to kind of master. And to play it with real money, you need to, you know, really be good at it in order to excel at it. So we've seen that the traction is there definitely for the game of poker in India. The market is opening up with more and more people joining the bandwagon. We've seen a lot of people shift from Rummy to poker or take poker as the first skill-based card game which they've learned. So our business in the last 2 years has, you know, scaled phenomenally. We are one of the fastest growing platforms in the country. And before the COVID crisis, we were at an accelerated growth path. What the business is all about is customer acquisition, customer retention, and customer engagement. So I believe the corona epidemic has, you know, accelerated the customer acquisition bit for most of the organizations on this platform. And it is similar for us. Our sudden customer acquisition rates have gone up. The engagement levels have gone up. And definitely as an industry, we see a lot more people picking up poker because of the kind of game it is. It is a lot more faster than Rummy. It is a lot more, you can say, new age than Rummy. And the audience is definitely taking up the game of poker. And we believe it will become a game of masses in the next 5 years. It's a very exciting time for us. And I mean, this entire epidemic has just made the customer acquisition and the engagement levels higher for our users.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Warren. I'm going to skip Manish for this particular question because he has already covered his pre-COVID and post-COVID experience prior to this session on his keynote. Let me get back to my second question. And again, I'll start with you, Varun, while you're on the screen here. I would like to know, as an outsider, I'm sure a lot of people who are new to gaming who are listening to us today, what was one, maybe at best two, surprising things that you have noticed since the COVID crisis hit us? Obvious things, I mean, I would know as a layman, and I'm sure other people would know, you know, people sitting at home, of course, they would be playing more, and games tend to be addictive, so I'm sure the usage is higher, right? What are some of the nuances that we don't understand, or some of the surprise, some things that surprised you even, something that you felt, this is not obvious. It was not obvious to us, and it was not obvious to you. Tell us, share something, and I want all the panelists to answer the same question. What was one thing, if you had to pick, that even surprised you since the COVID crisis?
Well, there have been, you know, getting into a startup, you have to kind of be prepared for these surprises and the unknowns. But every day there is a new challenge and a new surprise which comes your way. I mean, the first pointer which I would like to talk about in this entire epidemic is let's divide the last 1.5 odd months into two zones, when it started and when people actually got to understand that this is something which is long term. So we saw a sudden boost in, you know, our deposits, for example, because people thought that, you know, it's a 2 weeks holiday which they're getting when they're working from home. But suddenly we realized that, you know, okay, this is long term. This will continue for probably 6 months, 4 months. We don't know what kind of time frames we are looking at over here. So we did see that a lot of our users who had initially started depositing very huge volumes, they kind of tapered off. They kind of, you know, started to put in the volume which they were doing before the COVID scene exploded. So we saw a little peak. Then there has been a pretty stable plateaued growth coming in from the last 15-20 days from those set of users. That was point number A we noted. Point number two, which we noted, was a lot of people coming in from different parts of the country and playing the game of poker. So primarily the traffic from tier one and metros is something which we are, you know, get we have the maximum traffic coming from these areas. But definitely traffic from smaller cities, smaller states has picked up like anything. The game of poker is now, I can tell you, hugely popular in, say, Bihar, in Jaipur, in Indore. We're seeing a lot of people coming on from these states and picking up the game, which is very heartening to see, because it tells me that, you know, yeah, the people in different parts of the country will pick up the sport. And once they try and experience it, definitely they'll get better and they'll spend more and more time on it. So these are two things which I've noticed in the last 45 odd days, which have been heartening and kind of been something which impacts my business on a daily basis.
Varun, thank you. Good to hear that. I'll actually go to Manish. I know, Manish, you guys have a very diversified portfolio at Nazara. I'm sure you have quite a few, if not surprises, quite a few interesting things to share. If you could again pick one or two things that that this COVID-19 has thrown at you, either a challenge, a positive surprise, any nuances that some of us would not, as laymen, see from outside, anything that you can share?
See, I think two things. On a lighter note, I think after 2006, when I left Hindustan Lever to 2020, after 14 years, my extended family in small town of UP is appreciating what I do. So they used to understand my line of work when I used to sell detergent and be in the that time, and they knew that there's a Hindustan Lever stockist. And after that, they thought I'm just wailing away my time. So thankfully now they know that, okay, there is something which he's doing could be productive of use to them. So I'm very pleased that I don't need to explain to them what do I do to make my living. On the other note, I think for Nazara, and as you, Raju, rightly said, was we are having a very, very difficult choices to make. Once part of our portfolios are growing very fast, other part of our portfolio, we have to quickly change our mindset and look at companies which are dependent on live sports, on how do we really look at cost optimization, how do we look at really thinking it through, lying low, running our operations, but keeping the morale of the people right. How do we use this time to build capacity and capability and then come out stronger once the COVID is there? So you have a very different messaging, which I have to do during a course of two interactions, which are back to back. One is very expansive mindset, and other is very survival mindset. So I think that's, to me, is an amazing experience personally, to really be on a very different mindsets in a matter of seconds.
Great, Manish, that's good to hear. Thank you for that. And let me ask Pawan what are some of his new learnings or experiences and nuances from this COVID crisis.
Sure. So to be very honest, I mean, just anecdotally sharing something interesting, which for 1 or 2 days you thought is an aberration, but then of course it's the trend is continued. So we are like very sure of this insight. Basically, for us, for our platform, the initial peak time used to be at 10 p.m. in the night. And I think that holds good for most of the content related platform, why they're called prime time. Since the lockdown, at least our prime time has started, or it's basically shifted 360 degrees, and currently the highest traffic on our app is at 10 a.m. in the morning. which basically means that people usually get up, they have their breakfast and all, and then they just sit, start playing games. And I'm sure it's going to be very similar. Another interesting thing is there is more traffic on weekdays than weekends. So again, something, I don't know, I will sort of crack this out, but are people taking a break from smartphones over weekends? I don't know what's exactly happening. So this is something which is, again, that very, very specific to what we are observing. Talking about how I think we are also in a spot, just like Manish mentioned, right? Of course, we are in a stage where we are thinking about how we should really plan out for resources, what kind of games should we acquire. Everything in a way is changing post-COVID, right? If you see the kind of titles that we thought we would be acquiring maybe 12 months down the line, interested in acquiring because we feel that this year is going to be booming and we'll be able to do justice to that. And suddenly, of course, recently scaled also to that level. So that is something which is, and I think, you know, from a business planning point of view, right from the kind of titles we need to acquire to the kind of marketing spends you need to do. Another interesting thing, for example, when we are doing digital marketing, you can clearly see that our cost per installs have reduced by and large because our conversions have improved. On a regular day, if somebody is watching an ad, there are the likelihood of that person trying out what that ad really means versus in times of lockdown where there is ample amount of time and people are more than happy to explore what's the real product behind that advertisement has definitely improved. So that is, again, I think something which is in our favor. We are right now in a business planning mode and figuring out what we need to do. Our data science team is like on a regular basis trying to come up with next 3 months, 6 months projections as to what kind of numbers we can tweak and we can pass on those benefits to our partner developers. That's essentially where we are.
Great, Pawan, your shift to 10 a.m. peak time is definitely a little bit of a concern for me. I'm sure I guess people were expecting this work from home thing has been very productive. I've been hearing from all our portfolio companies that people are as productive as before. But this 10 a.m. shift, I'm a little concerned. That's the
I didn't want to bring this up. I didn't want to bring this up, but that was the first thing that as a co-founder, I also wondered that what's wrong with people? Are they starting off their day with playing games? But hopefully, I think for everybody's respite, I want to tell you that majority of my user base is from tier 2 to tier 5 cities. And unfortunately, those guys don't have the luxury to work from home because majority of those guys usually have to be physically present in their offices. So yeah, I think people who are asking their folks to work from home, I should not be that worried as well.
And I think just to build on Pawan's point, Raju, you shouldn't be worried. These are a lot of these guys are shopkeepers who can't open their shops. And now after doing their morning breakfast, puja, whatnot, they have nothing left to do for the day to begin and hence make some money.
No worries, Manish.
That's how they're planning to make money.
No worries, as long as our companies make money and people continue to be at least semi-productive, I think we are happy. But a last part to round it off, this question, anything from your end, Part?
So, yeah, so we also got a spike in tier one users, like similar to Winzo. I would say, I mean, even the tier one audience are used to taking those chai breaks during the offices and now those chai breaks have turned into a quick game on the apps, right? And also staying physically disconnected, like people want to try out and call their colleagues and come for a match, let's say a PUBG match or a Ludo, right? So tier one was a surprise for us. I mean, we were vernacular in nature, so we also kind of acquired the tier two, tier three earlier, but COVID gave us the tier one audience as well. And also I noticed something that came out to be a surprise was there was a shift in user base. I mean, there was a transition from casual to more serious gamers in this COVID time. I mean, people were acquainted with the games already and they were skilled at those, but now they are spending on it. They are depositing more money and then trying to, you know, leverage their skill and earn out of it. So that transition phase from casual to serious has happened during COVID. COVID has actually acted as a catalyst in that.
And I mean, tier one definitely is one thing. And age is one factor which Manish also highlighted. I mean, the average gamer earlier stood between 20, 25, right? So now even on our platform, we are seeing 35, 36 years of age and coming across from India and helping, like connecting with fam friends and families and playing multiplayer. So multiplayer earlier was a little downside because like we see that we need to have more concurrent users to play multiplayer games, right? And right, during the COVID, more people having screen time and more people logged in. Our average time went up, spent on the app, that's like 50 minutes right now, and multiplayer games happening more and more. So these are the key points which EVOR as an app we saw coming as a surprise. But somehow we had anticipated being a startup. I mean, when lockdown happened, right, in China, and then our prime minister calling out for a lockdown in India, we also took our measures to scale ourselves up so that we were ready. We are ready to cater to a broader user base.
Great, Parth. Thank you for that. So actually, moving on to the next question. As venture investors, we are as you can imagine diversified across technology into various sectors, and some of the research we have done for the past 5-6 weeks since the COVID crisis hit. To see what sectors are getting impacted during the crisis and how these sectors are going to be impacted either positively or negatively into the future. Because we believe the long lockdown that we are part of today is going to permanently change some behaviors, right?
Hello.
I think we've lost you.
Yeah, I think we lost Adesh.
Yeah, I thought it was my network, but.
Oh.
Seriously. For a second, the moment yeah. Parth showed up on the screen, I was like, thank God it's not me.
Same here.
Okay.
So we have a lot of questions that have come our way. So I'll just start out with reading out the names and if we can give them the audio. So first question we have from Riken. Can we have the audio of Riken?
Hello.
Yes, Riken, go ahead, please.
My question was actually in the last segment. Picked up, so I need to ask the question right now.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, my question was to Manish that how they're taking the stigma of the Indian parents that they encourage them to buy the subscription for the age of 2 to 6 years because Nazara has just started into that segment. So I would like to know that how they are planning the market, what they are doing to make sure that the parents go for the subscription for their young children.
Hi, do you have young children?
Yeah, I do have two daughters.
How old are they?
One is 6 years, one is 8 years, and one is 12.
And does your wife work?
Yeah, she works.
Right. So, what do you do to get a sigh of relief?
I know where you're going. So we do provide them mobiles and technology. That's not the question. Because I don't know whether you remember or not, Manish, but we have met in your Nazara office. I have similar app in the learning zone for the 2 to 6 years age group.
So yeah, dekho, my point of view is very simple. Can you take kids away from mobile devices? Some parents who are able to do it, great, but most of us have failed in that desire. And kids are having, and they will be on mobile devices and they will do it. Now you have two choices. You give them a content which is safe and can really help them entertain and subliminally they can learn something, or you can kind of give them a free jungle to roam around where you don't know what they encounter. And I think that's the, as a parent, is a choice which you make. And when you are making that choice, you obviously lean towards safe, nice entertainment with some subliminal learning which can happen. And that's where I think is a very good content play, because we have seen ourselves, if it is too much of education, kids run away. They are not dumbs. They are very smart. And the moment they smell that your parents are trying to, in the garb of entertainment, trying to dish out something which is learning, they will run away. So there is a fine balance. And I think that is where Kidopia has struck the good balance with the kids. And if kids are really attached to it, parents don't mind spending money, and the acceleration of subscription happens. Now, acceleration of subscription is also a function of per capita income. And you have to really have that kind of a mindset and that peace of mind to spend that much on as a discretionary spend and be okay with it. It becomes easier in case of education, but it is also a question of per capita income. And that's why, for example, Kidopia is really a big hit in the US and in Europe. In India, we're still seeing that the LTV CAC equations are still not very apt. And hence, we are not spending too much money on India, while we are really accelerating the pedal on the Western, on the US and European markets.
Okay. Thank you. The next question that we have is from Tarun Lala.
Hi, folks. Thank you. I actually had posted my question in the previous segment. So I have two questions with your permission. My first question was with the session with, Manish, where he said, we have a larger market size. And of course, they also diversify from different cities. So the question is here, I mean, if we want to launch something to, of course, ride the COVID wave, but also, you know, there is a market independent of the COVID wave. One side he said larger market, which of course the willingness to pay may be a little less. I don't know, I could be wrong about this. If we need to launch during this time, do we need to, launch freemium? Do we need to diversify our revenue streams, or launching now means we need to keep the positioning very, very crisp for one type of market? Is it paid? Is it not? Or is the free market, is the free adoption necessary in order for them to convert to the paid guys as well? That's the first question. And the second question was when, Pavan and Parth mentioned that you are seeing a broader audience with a higher age. Is that a good or bad thing from a point of view that, do you think these guys are going to disappear once work starts, or was COVID the push towards the inertia that these guys needed to get over in order to come and adopt these platforms, and do you see them continuing on?
So Tarun, Vanish here. I think answer is very simple. COVID, no COVID. Anytime, if you want to succeed, you need to have a very sharp offering and quickly really strive to find that product market fit from monetization and retention point of view. So I don't think those basic 101 principles change. If you have already found product market fit, you can accelerate. And I think, as Pavan said, your cost of acquisition may be lower today and you can take advantage of that. Or your retention may be higher because people spending more time and having more time at their discretion. But if you are still not able to find your product market fit, I think COVID or no COVID is not going to change. You have to really iterate and get towards that. So diversification could be at multiple offerings, but each offering has to succeed on its own.
All right. Thank you, Manish. Rajesh, we had a question from the previous session for Pavan from Manish Jain. So I'll just let him ask the question. Manish, if you're there, please ask your question.
Manish Jain.
Hi, Pawan. This is Manish Jain. I put up that question to Manish also, like, but he suggested you will be the best person for that. Like, what kind of these games are legally allowed to be played by players for the purpose of purely objective of winning money and all?
Yes. So, I mean, there is a three-word answer to it, 30-word answer to it, and 3,000-word answer to it. But I'll try to really keep it crisp. So, as per the guidelines or as per the regulatory framework of the country, any game of skill, wagering over game of skills is allowed. So, of course, now the entire debate happens on what is game of skill and what is not. For example, some of the things, you know, as per Supreme Court's guideline in the past, you know, for example, Rummy, even I think in some court orders, fantasy has been considered to be game of skill, right? Some of the things that we ourselves know, like Teen Patti, like roulette, like, you know, all these dice games like Ludo, they're clearly game of chance, right? What's more important is that the dominant effect or the dominant factor of every game should be more of skill than chance. So wherever you think that, you know, if a person will continue to play, continue to practice, and with the help of the either hand-eye coordination or reflexes or knowledge or, you know, more dexterity or motor skills, a person will have an edge over somebody else. Those are considered to be game of skills. For example, games like carom, pool, or something like a PUBG, cricket, you know, these are considered to be game of skill. And wagering on them is allowed. So yes, people can actually play for real money tournaments and they can sort of win money also if they perform well.
So I think I'll add to that quickly. Basically, today you can equate a PUBG player to any other on the field sport, just like cricket or basketball, because he actually practices the game even when the tournament or contests are not there. And he has to be well equipped with the gameplay and everything. So spending time and attaining skill with that game and then the government giving clearance to the skill-based games. So I think it's very interesting to have these games being played for real money, because actually you are putting in your real skills out there and then competing and have an ambition to, you know, beat your competitor and team up and hand and eye coordination and then getting well equipped with the gameplay. So it's very justified to have these games being played for the real money aspect, right?
And this is a larger question. So maybe we should ask Roland also to comment. I was going to ask this question on the panel. There's a lot of confusion about regulations around these so-called skill-based games. And I know the industry has been working hard to make sure that there is support for legally and from the government. Roland, if you could also expand on that, to see what you've been doing and what the industry plans to do into the future to make sure that the gaming doesn't hit roadblocks legally.
Yeah, thanks, Rajesh. So at the AGF, we, you know, since it's a state subject and there is no particular ministry, federal guidelines. So we follow the self-regulation mechanism, which has worked well for some of the other industries. We've been doing that for the last 4 years now. These are, you know, some of the parallel industries that that the Supreme Court also has supported self-regulation mechanisms are the ASCII, the Advertising Standards Council of India, the Indian Broadcasting Federation, which is supported by the MIB, Ministry for Information and Broadcasting. And similarly, we have made representations to the Ministry for Electronics and IT to have a similar positioning of, you know, kind of endorsing the self-regulation charters that the All India Gaming Federation have and the stakeholders have adopted. Now, all of these self-regulation guidelines are, you know, good governance do's and don'ts for stakeholders, whether it is, you know, the kind of KYCs being done, whether it is, you know, the deposits that are being collected or, you know, give payouts to the winners. All of those are put into charters, what we call charters that all stakeholders adopt to. And then, you know, there are also periodic annual audits that are done by one of the big four firms. And then they actually get a seal of recognition that they are audited and, you know, they comply with these charters. And this includes the not only the card games as well as fantasy, but it also includes the digital esports as well. So all the four categories. So now these have worked well. Our representations have been received very well. There are case laws. Prior to that, obviously, there are case laws from various high courts and also the Supreme Court, which categorize each of these as games of skills. We have also an expert committee panel at the AIGF, which is made up of some retired Supreme Court judges, some law and order experts, some data scientists and financial experts. And all of these have gone through those charters and, you know, have even looked at some of the innovations that some of the operators come up with within these four categories and, you know, categorize them also as games of skill. So as of now, I think for the immediate and, you know, the near future, you're right when you introduced, Rajesh, that Telangana is a no-go state as far as any online games for money is concerned. But all the operators and our members, you know, geo-block that state. Other than that, pretty much as of now, I don't think there are issues. There are some sporadic high court cases which the industry body AIGF has taken up, and those are sub judice. So now, you know, including the one in Telangana. So let's see how it goes. But as I think for now and for the future, I think gaming is online scale gaming for money is I don't see any such issues going forward.
That was basically a longish response that I mentioned of. Just one more thing. It'll be great if somebody can also share, you know, when you are asking the question, if you can also share the context in which you are asking the question so that we can answer probably a more pointed and more helpful, in a more helpful manner.
Sure, we can do that. Rajesh, can we move to the next question?
Pick up the next question.
Yeah. So next question we have from Vibha.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes,
yes. So I would really appreciate if someone can comment on the micro payments aspect of it and their compatibility with the current payment gateways. I would address this question to Pawan.
Okay, thank you so much. I think this is that should definitely be touched upon in this discussion. Glad you brought it up. So essentially, when we started it off, I'll tell you, you know, very quickly, we'll try to, sort of summarize. When we launched this platform, we started off with subscription packages. Subscription packages were more like, you know, like SKUs of different durations. Like you pay 49 rupees for 1 week, you pay 500 rupees for 1 month, and so on and so forth. We realized that while people were interested, the top selling pack was always the 1 day pack, which was, I think, of 20 rupees or something, right? Which was very clear that people want to try it out, and then people were repeatedly buying it off again and again, which means that if you look at tier 2, tier 5 audience, the affordability is for a large chunk of them is not very high, right? And secondly, there is a massive trust deficit there. People want to sort of make transactions, but they definitely always want to start off with a low amount. Keeping these two things in mind, what we did was we completely got rid of our subscription module. We added a wallet, in-app wallet within the app. Now people can simply top up this wallet by, you know, either Paytm or debit cards and all. And then they can keep on spending. Let's say I add 50 rupees and then I will keep on spending this 50 rupees across games, across formats in the entire Winzo mobile app ecosystem. Interestingly, the smallest, I would say, you know, our entry ticket or the smallest entry ticket that sort of goes by in our platform is 2 rupees. And interestingly, that is one of the frequent or the most frequent transaction or entry fee that's usually being played by 60 to 65% of our user base. Now, what happens as a result of which is, while a person is feeling that he's only spending 2 rupees, but you know, a person doing 20 gameplays in a day and probably, let's say, you know, close to 600 gameplays in a month will eventually end up spending close to 1200 rupees. If you take even 10% take rate of that, you are earning around 100-150 rupees from a person in a month's time, but at his own leisure. If I would ask the same person to pay me 150 rupees upfront, just the way Hotstar does or Netflix does, Probably not. They will not be interested in buying those packs. But because we give them the flexibility to start from as low as 2 rupees to manage their wallet balances that they way they like, I think that works out well for them. And it helps us also do, if not more, around 100 million microtransactions in a month. So that's what it is. One more thing I want to also, interesting anecdote I want to share it, is when we are starting off, we realized that we had Paytm to add wallet, add money in our app wallet, right? One of my developers asked me that, why do we need to add the option of debit cards here? If people are sort of, having monies in their Paytm, they might as well be doing it via debit cards itself, right? So we spoke to a couple of people, and those people told us that they actually go to some of these shops, they pay them cash, like they'll pay the shopkeeper probably 105 rupees and the shopkeeper deposits 100 rupees in their Paytm wallet. That is how a large chunk of the audience in tier 2, tier 5 is still thriving. I mean, I'm not sure what the percentage is now, but that time, what I'm talking about is something towards end of 2017 or early 2018. When though everybody in tier one knew, and this is post demonetization, right? But still a lot of people didn't have the means to add money in their Paytm wallets. So that's the state of Indian digital, I would say, of digital payments sort of ecosystem.
Varun, you would want to add to that maybe?
Definitely. So there are 2-3 things I would like to add to what Pawan has added, said. The first thing, which is very important to gain the trust of a user, and especially when you're using real money gaming, is the security of the payment which is coming in and also the security of the payment which is going out. So when I say the digital payment mechanism in our industry, it has to do both with deposits and withdrawals. So what we saw in poker specifically was when we entered, there was a little bit of mistrust with respect to the withdrawals from the users and the customers. So we ensured we are paying out the users instantly in order to gain their trust. And that was, I think, one of the biggest things we got onto the table back in 2018 was when we introduced instant withdrawals. So basically a user will get the money back into their bank account in less than 10 seconds once they click on the withdrawal button. And that encouraged the users to come and spend more time on our platform, to come and spend more money on the platform. A typical average transaction on poker platform is roughly between 1,000 and 1,500, which is very different from what it is for other casual games, where the ticket size can be as low as 2 rupees per transaction. In our business, the typical ticket size is a little higher because that is the nature of our business is slightly different from the casual games. But the comfort of withdrawal is basically what helps these users to gain the trust to deposit a certain more amount of volume onto the platforms. And I think it is very important and that the trust is maintained by all the platforms and the players. Another very important thing which has happened during this last 2.5 years is the ecosystem which has evolved. So when we started, Paytm didn't used to support online poker. They had a apprehension on giving out their wallets. But since the last 1 year, we are now using Paytm, and it is contributing a lot from the tier 2, tier 3 cities where people don't have credit cards and they don't want to swipe credit cards on gaming platform, but they don't mind spending 100, 500 rupees on their Paytm wallets. So I believe the ecosystem, the way it has evolved, has really helped the deposits, the withdrawals. And there is a lot of technology now which is being used to verify whether people are legitimately making these transactions or are these fraudulent transactions as well, which is also very important to ensure a fair gameplay. So, I mean, there are a lot of different aspects to digital payments in the gaming ecosystem. And it is very important for us operators to integrate the best practices, to integrate the technology which is available to us to ensure a fair and transparent gameplay as well. So those are important aspects which I wanted to, touch upon after Pavan's input, which was bang on.
Rajesh, can we move to the next question, please?
Please do.
Yeah. So next question we have from Dharani Dharan. Can we have the audio, please?
Hello.
Yes.
Hi, good afternoon. This is Dharani. I represent the Ministry of Belgium. entity like which supports investment and export between India and Belgium. So my question is, will you be seeing Indian startups with the potential to scale up in the near future, taking a call and moving to a more matured market, maybe like to European Union? Will we be seeing companies, for example, like some of the AI-based startup companies, they are postponing their investment plans to 2021. So it's open to anyone. So will we be seeing any Indian startups moving abroad anytime soon? Thank you.
Rajesh, would you want to toss that question to anyone you want?
I think we can, if we still have Manish online.
I don't think we have Manish.
I can maybe have I would just want to add a line to it, and then maybe Rajesh can sum it up. So see, we are speaking to, it's Pavan this side from Vinzo. We are speaking to game developers across the world, right? As long as a two-member team to as big as a very large game studio. And of course, if you know there are certain good, great game developers out there in Belgium, we'll be more than happy to onboard their games, get into commercial contracts and all of that.
So Parth, you have anything to add to this?
Yeah, I think it's similar in our case as well. So it's not only the Indian developers who are building games. There are a lot of interesting concepts being coming up outside India as well. So like the growth outside is immense. Like we see Fortnite and other games develop in the space outside India. So we love to collaborate with people outside India, and definitely scaling the audience outside as well would be on our plate sooner, like in the coming few months. But would love to have developers and people, stakeholders in gaming industry from outside to collaborate with eWar Games.
Great. Saurabh, in terms of time check, how many more questions we have? And
we have a lot of questions, but as you wish, I mean, we can take a couple of more maybe before we wrap up if you want.
Okay, please, let's take two more questions.
Okay, all right. So the next question we have from Jackie.
Hello.
Go ahead, Jackie.
Yeah, hi. So I wanted to know, what do you think is the future in India in the next 5 years? Would it be the freemium game like Clash of Clans? Would it be real money game like Poker or Rummy? Or will it be games like PUBG, which are multiplayer games?
So I think I can answer to that. So like Manish said, it cannot be only one specific side of game. I mean, it has to be the entire, because Indians are liking almost everything, starting from the casual addictive games to hardcore battles in PUBG and Free Fire, and even poker and Teen Patti Rummy are like played crazy in India. So what I see is esports would go as big as e-commerce and even more than that. I mean, I'm sensing that parents are going to spend on headphones and laptops for gaming for their kids so that they can build out a profession in there. So the industry is going to go very big. There would be stakeholders like content creators and hardcore gamers and game. These guys would be managed by managers. So not only a single game would take up the bigger piece of cake. I mean, it would be all different segments, indigenous games and even outside games coming from outside. So it would be the entire plethora of games.
See, Jackie, it's Pavan this side from Vinzo. Just want to add to something. The total size of the gaming, you know, global gaming industry is $139 billion, which is cumulatively greater than the size of the entire movie industry as well as the size of the entire music industry, right? Now, your question is, you know, I'll tell you what. Your question is similar to what kind of movies would people like 5 years from now? Whether it's going to be horror, it's going to be comedy, or it's going to be action. Now, the answer to that is any great movie that will be well made, that will be, you know, catered to the masses, that will be relatable to the masses,
right,
will definitely click. Whether it's casual, whether it's semi-core, whether it's multiplayer, whether it's real money. I think to be very honest, each and every model has its own niche. And that niche in itself is, by the way, double-digit $1 billion that we're talking about. It's not as niche as the word niche sounds. So we just need to focus on picking the thing that really excites us the most if you are, let's say, planning to develop your great game, and then just ace it. And I'm very sure that there is going to be more than takers for that kind of a model. And as far as monetization goes, again, right, it really depends, because I know a lot of people, you know, who are excellent in monetizing their games. But when you talk about real money gaming, they don't even understand those concepts, you know. They don't understand how the real money economy within a platform would work. And on the other side, there's some of the experts on real money side of things, probably, you know, poker, rummy operators. If you speak to them and you tell them that, hey, how would a freemium model or in-app purchase driven model would work, they wouldn't have a clue about it. So it really depends on the metal of the team, the vision of the founders and the creators into creating something phenomenal. As far as potential, as far as scope is concerned, it's humongous across categories.
Well said, Pawan. Just to summarize, yes, we as investors also believe that the industry is going to be large. The question has always been, when would it become a large industry in India? It's never been the question of if. And agree with everybody who has answered that question. I think there are going to be a lot of genres, just like Pawan mentioned in the movie industry, and there are going to be a lot of sub-segments within gaming industry. The industry is large enough that multiple people or multiple companies can play in each of the sub-segments. So Saurabh, one last question.
Sure. So last question we have from Jayesh.
Hello.
Jayesh, please go ahead.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay, great. So my question is to the panel around the recent platforms that enable hosting these online tournaments, tournament style games for games like PUBG and all, for small entry amounts, and then the result is that the winner takes all and the platform retains a percent of the overall pool. I just wanted to understand what kind of future these platforms and have, and are they even legal? And what is their dependency on the game IP owners to facilitate such tournaments?
Let me ask actually Warren if you could answer that question better than I know. Hello.
Yeah, Rajesh, I'm there.
Warren, I know poker similar style tournaments that he was asking about are done in poker also, right?
True.
Both offline and online. Maybe you can comment on that.
So the legality is pretty much, we've discussed it. Roland has explained it. Pawan has explained it. As long as your sport is classified as a game of skill, you can monetize it by wagering of money, and you can do a tournament style revenue model as well. So the legality of the game is pretty much the functionality of the skill levels involved in the game. Now, what is it that the IP aspect of the of streaming of these tournaments and how do you monetize them? So typically in poker, how it works is that there is a 10% service fee which is charged by the operators against all the kind of guarantees which are promised for the tournaments, and the money is distributed pretty much between 20-25% of the audience who plays the tournament. So for example, if 100 people are playing, around 20 positions would be paid, and there would be a 10% service fee which would be levied by the operator in this particular domain. Tournaments are important, especially for poker, rummy, skill-based card games, because they are a huge crowd puller. So to acquire the customers, they act as a very good tool for us to kind of say, hey, you can put in 1,000 rupees and you can try and multiply your money if you come first. And they are a very good advertiser of the skill level which is required in the gameplay, because you're competing against 100 people on a similar battlefield, which is giving you equal opportunities. So people who are more skillful, who are having a higher level of skill, they kind of do better in these tournaments over a period of time. So if you look at the kind of number of professional poker players in the country, these guys are pretty much there in every big tournament which happens in the country, be it offline, online. So you would see those 50, 100, 150 names doing well consistently, which kind of reattributes the fact that it is a game of skill and people with higher level of skill set will do well. I would also like to add another small point, which will answer the previous question as well, around how do you see the game happening in the next 3 to 5 years. So I believe there is going to be a hero culture around all these sports very soon. We will have heroes coming up from day-to-day life who will, you know, be the brand ambassadors for these games. There would be soon be a person in India who will probably win 5 crores, 10 crore rupees tournaments. And they will be, branded as the cult classic heroes of that particular game. This is the same phenomena which happened in the US in 2000 when there was a poker player who had won a $1 million from a $1 satellite ticket. And that really gave the craze of that sport in the country. So this will happen in our country as well. There would be someone who will win $1 million PUBG tournaments, or there would be a player who will win $1 million poker tournament. And that will really create the entire awareness, that will create the messaging around these sports. So we need the heroes to come from day-to-day life, janta, and it will happen very soon is what my belief is. And that is how I see the tournaments happening as a very good customer acquisition tool for our business.
I think Varun is absolutely right. I mean, we would be definitely seeing Virat Kohli's and Dravid's in esports sooner. I mean, people are that ambitious about esports game that they want to compete with their teams with one versus one. So we'll be seeing a lot of heroes coming up soon.
Great, good to hear. Saurabh, we are done.
So if you have any parting thought before
I... I want Roland to kind of conclude this session by maybe sharing with all of us, Roland, what should the industry look forward to over the next 12 months and 24 months? I'm sure you have a better view of the overall industry, where it is and where it's heading. If you could just take a few seconds to summarize for us what everyone listening in today should expect for this industry over the next 12 months.
Yeah, thank you, Rajesh. Actually, I didn't get a chance to comment when you were asking about that one thing that, you know, surprised us in the period of this lockdown. So I was at the ICE conference in London in early February. And, you know, while I was preparing for that presentation, some of which Pawan just mentioned, but you know, I was referring to what Ruchir Sharma mentioned to NDTV in mid-Jan. And he mentioned that, you know, the world has a favorite pastime, and that is gaming now. Okay. And close to a $138 billion industry, much bigger than films, music put together. And the average revenue per user, these are global numbers, for a game like Fortnite is close to $100. Compare that to with in any social media platform, which is hardly a two-digit dollar number. Now, India is moving in that direction, you know, with the number of game downloads, with the number of game development companies, with the number of, startups in the ecosystem. And definitely, you know, this was reiterated when Mr. Mukesh Ambani was with Satya Nadella, and he mentioned it himself also that, you know, gaming is going to be bigger than TV, music, movies put together. So, you know, that's the kind of outlook I would like to leave this session with, that, you know, in the next 3 to 5 years, this is going to be the next one of the biggest contributors to the Indian economy.
Thank you, Roland. And our expectations as investors is very similar to your summary there, Roland. We believe this is going to be a massive industry. And I think, like Manish was mentioning, the product market fit is important. For all the entrepreneurs listening in, it's not the worry about the market size anymore. I think the market size is gaining traction and is accelerating. The size is not going to be an issue, which was an issue, by the way, as investors for us. It was too small of a market to invest over the last 10 years. That's not an issue anymore. Now the question is finding the right entrepreneurs, right products that would really grow and catch on with the masses out there is what we are looking for. And for entrepreneurs, just building a great product and making sure that the product market fit is there. And if you can find that out early on, which is not easy, by the way, early on, the better off you are. So I would like to thank all the panelists. Thank you for your time. I think that was a very interesting exchange. And I hopefully all the people who joined us today got enough information, ideas, thoughts, to either participate in this industry or be supporters of this industry, because I truly believe this is the next big thing for India. And thank you, Entrepreneur Magazine, and you guys to invite all of us here and share our thoughts. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Rajesh.
Thanks a lot, guys. In case there were more pending questions, feel free to reach out to any of us on LinkedIn independently. Happy to take more questions and help in any way at all.
Thank you, Raghu. Thank you, Saurabh.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you all.
Just one request to the attendees. At the end of the session, there will be a small survey form. If you can fill that, it will help us in improving the topics and everything going forward. Thank you to all our panelists, and a very special thank you to Rajesh, you for moderating the session. We hope to see you soon again. Thank you so much.
Thank you all. Take care.
Bye.
Thank you.